Thanks, Riley. I love it when a message comes together. Riley and I haven't talked about what I was going to share with you this morning, but it's a lot about love and lifting up. So how good is that? So we can be expectant. So I've called this message today two encouragements. I started at three, whittled it back to two, so you're already on bonus there. My husband Neil and I, we've just come back from our second pilgrimage. So 8 years ago, we walked a part of the Camino Santiago. Have you heard that? The Way of St. James. And this year in September, we went to Italy and we walked the Way of St. Francis. So we had 3.5 weeks. We walked over 400 kilometres, 500,000 steps, a lot of going straight up, straight down. Old lady legs made it. It was great. It was really good. But it's been a huge 3 months. When you do a spiritual walk like that, and if you ever get an opportunity to do a spiritual walk, you know, a walk where you're praying, where you're intentionally seeking God. There's lots of ways you can do that, by the way. You don't have to go overseas and do a pilgrimage. There's a great walk up in Darlington, for example. You can spend a whole day just walking and praying, drinking coffee, walking, praying. It's just a wonderful thing to do. But it's also an intense thing to do. There's a lot of preparation that goes on when you do one of these kind of spiritual walks to take some time out. So this last 3 months for us has just been enormous. We had the pilgrimage, there was all the preparation, there were things that happened. And to be honest, as I've come back and people said, well, how was it? The only way I can express it is that I feel like I've swallowed seven mountains. Like it's just been enormous. And so I'm really carrying that as I come and share with you this morning. And so you'll probably get a sense of like there's a bit of weight here because I'm still processing so much of what the Lord has been speaking to me about and how he's continuing to shape and form me. Which means I've already forgotten to say something, and that is hi to all our friends at Merriwa. It's good to see you. And I had that right at the top of my page. So let's get stuck into it. So I wonder how I've been thinking and I'm wondering how expectant you are to hear from the Lord this morning. And it's been great to share and worship with you to see you are expecting to hear from the Word. So I'm glad about that. But I want to share with you at least two of the reflections that have been shaping and forming in my heart, not just in the pilgrimage, but really I can look back and see how the Lord has been speaking to me this year. So I come to you as a friend. I come to you as a fellow follower of Jesus. And I simply want to just share my heart with you today. So I'm not going to do any preaching or sort of direct teaching as such. I just want to reflect in the goodness of God because God gives us good gifts to share. And so I'm praying that as I share these things with you, they will enliven your heart and your soul as well. I'm also coming to you today with this prayer that you will receive a revelation. Revelation is what happens in our hearts, in our souls, when the Spirit of God gives us an aha moment. Often revelations are things that we already know about. A revelation is a movement from something that we know that's kind of true, and it gets into our hearts and it becomes a lot about who we are and how we walk in the world. In other words, a revelation often comes in a moment, but you can often trace it back and see how the Lord has been leading and teaching your heart. Does that make sense? Yeah. So let me give you an example of what a revelation could look like. There was a time when I understood what compassion was. I read all the Bible passages about compassion, and I understand that compassion is something that you feel towards someone else. 1 Corinthians 1, 3 to 5 says this, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. For just as we share abundantly in the sufferings of Christ, so also our comfort abounds through Christ." You get that? We receive the compassion of God, and from that compassion and the comfort that comes, we are then called to share that in the world. We know that God has compassion for all people. He knows our pain and he comes to us with his immense comfort. Now, I knew this. And for many years, I put this into practice in my life. Sometimes you have to work at these spiritual truths, don't you? And I can look back and see how I had learned to grow in capacity to have compassion for people and to be with people in pain and discomfort, because often you just want to run away and leave it to someone else, don't you? Even as a pastor, run away, run away. But there was a day when compassion became a wholly different reality in my life, and it came when I received this revelation moment from the Spirit. I happened to be with a girl who was deeply troubled. She was quite close to me at this time, and in fact, she had brought immense pain into my life and to the life of my family. And I was angry, and I was hurt, I was tired. And there came this day, and I was holding her in my arms because that's what you do, and I really did genuinely care. But I wanted the pain to end. And I remember just holding her in my arms and suddenly experiencing a revelation from God of His compassion. I know what compassion is, and now I was experiencing it with this girl. I didn't have to manufacture it, didn't have to manipulate it. It just flowed as a new truth. A new gift from the Spirit that flowed out. I couldn't push her away. Instead, I just fell deeply in love with her and was able to be with her in her pain and to offer her, I guess, a more profound experience of being with someone who knows and loves God. Does that make sense? A revelation absolutely changes us. And so that's what I'm praying for us today and for you as I share with you these two things. So in terms of expectations, I'm not going to share with you anything new or clever, but what I'm going to share with you is what's been put in my heart. The first encouragement is this. Number one, you are loved. Now, we all know that God loves us. We all know that God loves us so much that He sent Jesus into the world to free us from the power of sin and death. We know the love of God and we experience that to some degree. We know because we know the Holy Spirit lives in us and assures us that we are loved. And yet, there are parts of my life and yours that struggle to comprehend just how much we are loved by God. We know it up here, but sometimes we can struggle to comprehend how much we love because of the pain, the hardship, the disappointments, perhaps accumulated disappointments that we're holding in our hearts. Now, as I listen to people talk about their walk with Jesus, I'm hearing more and more this year people who are really insecure because they haven't yet been able to really fully grasp how much they're loved. We know Jesus loves us, but somehow we just can't access the stillness and the contentment and the peace that comes when we can just sit with God and know that we are loved. You know, sometimes maybe even our capacities and our competency, our pride, gets in the way of just being able to sit with God and know that we are loved. I sometimes watch myself and watch other people and go, it's almost like we come into the presence of God, but we project a future version of ourselves into that scene. Can you imagine just coming into the presence of God right now, looking at God in the face? And can you be fully present, or is there a bit of you going, well, one day when I get that bit sorted out, I'll bring all of that. We kind of just like hold back a bit. 1 John 3 says this, see how very much our Father loves us, for He calls us His children, and that is what we are. John, the writer of that letter, he was one of Jesus' disciples. He was perhaps one of Jesus' closest friends. He was also the last disciple to die. And there's a legend that says when John was an old man, people would come because they wanted to make connection with the last living person who was with Jesus when he was on earth. And so they would come and they would get really angry because they would ask John, what was Jesus like? What was Jesus like? What was Jesus like? And all John would say is, little children, you must love one another. John knew the love of Jesus, and he was so immersed in the love of Jesus, whenever you read his writings through the New Testament, they're just so full of peace because John had a security in his relationship with Jesus. He knew about the overflow of the love of Christ through his life. Earlier this year, in fact, it was on my birthday, a good friend of mine, and I know a good friend to many of you here at True North, passed away. It was Martin Sanders. He was my dear friend. He was my mentor. In many respects, he was my spiritual father. And as I was grieving his, I've been grieving his passing, I've been thinking about all of the good things that he passed into my life. And I realised that Martin, I think, sensed that I wasn't quite able to understand how fully loved I was. And he was always provoking me towards the love of the Father, as I'm sure he was provoking many of you. That was one of the things that Martin spoke about, was the love of the Father. He brought the love of the Father to whoever he was with and wherever he was serving. I couldn't watch Martin's memorial service in New York. It was just too hard to be away. And it's too lonely to grieve on your own, isn't it? We need to be together. The only part of the funeral service I could watch was when they played a film clip of Martin reading a children's book. And he'd videoed this for his grandchildren because he lived away from them. And he had this great voice, those of you who remember Martin, great voice. Now, it turns out that Martin's final gift of speaking into my life actually came through that film clip of Martin reading a children's book. Now, the name of the book I'm going to give to Riley at the end of the service, because I know you're all going to want to go out and buy this book because I'm about to read it to you. It's life-changing. The name of the book is Wherever You Are, My Love Will Find You by Nancy Tillman. But for now, so we don't get distracted, right? Let's stay in the zone. I'm going to ask you to open your heart as I read this book. I've paraphrased it a little bit. I'm asking you to be open to having faith like a child. This is not childish. This is an invitation to trust that our Heavenly Father, yours and mine, wants us to receive today a deep assurance of his real and very, very personal love. So you may want to close your eyes as you allow these words to touch your heart. This is God the Father speaking to us. I wanted you more than you will ever know. So I sent love to follow you wherever you go. Love is as high as you wish it. It's as quick as an elf. You'll never outgrow it. Love stretches itself. So climb any mountain, climb up to the sky. My love will find you. My love can fly. Make a big splash, go out on a limb. My love will find you. My love can swim. Love never gets lost, never fades, never ends. If you're working or playing or sitting with friends, you can dance till you're dizzy, paint till you're blue. There's no place, not one, that my love can't find you. And if someday you're lonely, or someday you're sad, or you strike out at baseball or think you've been bad, just lift up your face. Feel the wind in your hair. That's me, my dear child. My love is right there. In the green of the grass, in the smell of the sea, in the clouds floating by at the top of a tree, in the sound crickets make at the end of the day, you are loved. You are loved. You are loved, they all say. My love is so high and so wide and so deep. It's always right there, even when you're asleep. If you're still my small babe or all the way grown, my promise to you, you're never alone. So hold your head high and don't be afraid. My love will find you wherever you are. It's beautiful, isn't it? Where are you right now? Where's your heart right now? Are you in a place of peace, place of disappointment, place of apathy? Are things good with you? Wherever you are, God's love finds you, finds me, and meets us wherever we are. Because we are loved. We are loved. We are loved. This poem resonates with the revelation of God in the scriptures. I love this poem because every time I think of it, of that refrain, you are loved, you are loved, you are loved, I'm sort of shocked out of my adult familiarity with the scriptures. I'm shocked out of my adult familiarity with Jesus when I just simply hear those words, you are loved, you are loved, you are loved. This poem helps me to have a soft and tender heart. And so I've been praying that refrain, you are loved, you are loved, you are loved, will be like the grit in an oyster shell that just keeps irritating your heart. That's my blessing to you. May that continue to irritate in your heart. We lost a staff member at Riverview earlier this year, and one of the things that I keep thinking about is the very last words that I said to him was down the end of our staff room table. We were sharing communion together and I read that poem and I remember looking at him in the eyes saying, you are loved, you are loved, you are loved. The power of Jesus in that moment. And I pray that you will have lots of you are loved moments as you think about that and as the Spirit applies that to your heart. The second encouragement that I want to bring to you this morning is simply this, and we've already said this, it's to look up. When you're walking a pilgrimage and you're going up and down amazing mountains, following the footsteps of St. Francis of Assisi and thinking about his story, it wasn't all beautiful. There were parts that were really hard, and there are parts of beautiful Italy that are boring. Like just walking on the pavement, just the sheer drudgery of one foot in front of the other, just getting to the next place to stay. And I would have to stop and remind myself, you're in the middle of Italy. Look up. This is just gobsmackingly beautiful. Enjoy. Enjoy where you are. Who gets to walk on a pilgrimage? Like, this is amazing. And there was one occasion where I stopped and looked up, and I was suddenly reminded of all of the amazing passages of scripture that encourage us to look up. Just stop and look up and see what's going on around you. If you've had a Catholic or an Anglican background, you might be familiar with the words that happen in the liturgy when the church gathers and the priest says, lift up your hearts. And all the people say back, we lift them up to the Lord. 1 Chronicles 16:11 says, look to the Lord and to his strength. Seek his face always. Psalm 121, I lift up my eyes to the hills where my help comes from. Psalm 146, the Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. Can you just imagine yourself at the moment in the throne room of heaven? We would all be on our faces, right? In the presence of the Almighty God. And then imagine the Almighty God coming to you, and with his hands lifting up your face. That's what the psalmist is saying. You know, Psalm 3, my glory and the lifter of my head. This is how much we are loved, that God of all heaven comes to us and lifts up our faces. And we get to look at him face to face because we are so loved. Hebrews 12:2 says, we must keep our eyes on Jesus who leads us and makes our faith complete. This encouragement is to lift up our heads, particularly when it comes to praying. As a pastor, I get to talk to lots of people. I especially spend a lot of time with pastors. One of my roles is to help pastors as they're learning and practicing ministry. And as I've been listening to people and I've been listening to their prayers, one of the things I've noticed particularly lately is that we're very good at diagnosing what's going on around us. But what happens when we do that? And that's not bad, right? It's good to be aware of what's going on. It's good to get an understanding of what challenges we're facing or what's going on around us and to bring that to the Lord in prayer. But it got me wondering. When we only talk to God at the level of that which we're seeing, is that enough? Is actually the question I asked God the other day. Like, is that enough? It didn't quite feel right. I'd been talking to some youth pastors and they were really good at telling me about, you guys might want to block your ears here because this is about you, how distracted our young people are and all the pressures that the young people are like these group of young the youth pastors were really genuinely concerned about young people. And I could hear them praying about all these things, and I felt like saying, can you just stop for a minute? Because I wonder if when we're praying about that, God knows about all that stuff and he absolutely cares about all of that. But is that, have we pitched our prayers right? And then I started to think, look up. You see, when we pray, first of all, and we look up, God knows all the stuff that we care about. But when we look up, something changes, doesn't it? Because suddenly our prayers, we're looking at the face of the all-sufficient one. And when we don't look up first, we can tell God what's going on and we can talk about our concerns, but I wonder if it closes us off to what God would want to say to us. When we look up, it changes our perspective. And so instead of praying at this level, I'm saying, what if we said, all-sufficient one of heaven, Jesus, what is it that you want to do? Because you care about this way more than even we do. What is it that you want to say to us? One of the most important questions that I've learned to ask God is, God, what do you want me to pray? Show me what it is that you want me to pray, because that's when I see more miracles that way. In the ordinary, everyday, I'm not talking about the spectacular things, I'm talking about the ordinary, everyday, noticing where God is at work, because he is always at work. But if I'm looking here, I'm missing it, because my eyes are only limited by what I see here. And I also wonder if in some ways by not looking up first, we kind of insulate our hearts because we don't want to be disappointed by God in prayer. Can I urge you to keep looking up, to trust in the love of Jesus as you're praying? I come here this morning with a word of thanks because I know True North Community. I've known of you for a long time. I've been a witness to your history in many respects. And I know that you are a church who prays. And I've had opportunities to have times of praying with you in different parts of the True North community over the years. I'm particularly grateful that in June I got to be part of the women's retreat. And I want to say thank you because you blessed me so much that afternoon as I saw the women of this church wrap around each other in praying that I hadn't heard for a long time. Keep your heads up and keep praying, please, True North. And know that your praying is setting an example for the believers in this city. That's really important. I came away from that retreat really challenged. The Lord had placed something on my heart for the women of Riverview, and not just mine. I had had lots of conversations with women at Riverview. And as a result of that experience, we started gathering for a no-agenda prayer thing. We're asking God the question, what do you want for the women of Riverview? And amazing things are happening as we're getting together and we're learning to pray for one another. Heads lifted up. Learning to contend with one another. Learning to be steadfast for one another. That is a gift that you have given to us. And so this morning, I want to say thank you for that. As much as I'm calling you out to keep your heads lifted up. So may the Holy Spirit, may the Lord bless you richly through these two encouragements that I've shared with you this morning. May the Lord help you to keep your heart open to his shaping and forming work through the Spirit so that you can know with absolute fullness that you are loved. You are loved and you are loved. And may you, with well-loved hearts, overflowing with faith, continue to be a people who lift up your heads and hearts as you pray. Amen. These two encouragements that I've given to you today, I think, are lovely to hold in our hearts as we enter into a time of communion. And as we go into communion this morning, I simply wanted to share with you something that at Riverview has been a real joy and a blessing to us every time we take communion. We've been inviting people to share from our church. They just come up and share what's on their hearts, and it's a great way to get to know each other as we talk about what does communion mean to us? How have we seen the work of God. You know, we testify to the goodness of God, to the freedom that comes because of the love and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And so in a moment, I'm going to invite you to go and collect the emblems and take them in your own time. But can I first of all share with you this wonderful invitation? This invitation to communion, this is a table, not of the church, but of the Lord himself. It is made ready for those who love him and for those who want to love him more. So come. You who have much faith and you who have little faith, you who have been here before and you who have not been here long, you who have tried to follow and you who have failed, come. Because it is the Lord who invites you. It is his will that those who want him should meet him here. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Amen.